Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the podcast. Today is Friday here on the podcast of My Dear People, and today I'm sitting in Cam's office drinking French press coffee with Trina Beachy.
He said it was good coffee, so I feel successful.
Yeah, I've been pleasantly surprised because Trina said we couldn't talk about books without coffee, so I agreed.
It just doesn't work.
Pretty good. So yeah, today we're here to convince you why you should read books, I guess, and talk about books in general. But to start off, let's tell people who I'm talking to.
Okay, well, my name's Trina. I'm working right now at Fairplay Boys Camp. It's located in Westminster. Even though the name is Fairplay, the camp started in Fairplay.
I just noticed that today because I was looking at directions to make sure I could get here.
Uh-huh. And it wanted to take you to girls' camp?
Yeah, it did. Yeah. And I was like, it's not in Fairplay.
Yeah. So now there's a girls' camp at like the place where boys' camp used to be. And so even now, families, when they come out here for the first time, they often get rerouted over to girls' camp.
Yes. So what are you doing here?
So I'm the receptionist here. I answer phone calls. I type articles and reports and just kind of, keep an eye on
stuff.
Run
the place, basically.
I guess. No.
Cool. And where are you? You're not from here, right?
No. I was born in Maryland, but I moved here from West Virginia.
West Virginia.
7 years ago.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good. So we'll dive right in. The first thing we're going to talk about today is something important, I think, in the world. Why should people read books? So, myself and you, we both like to read, right?
Mm-hmm.
Today, this is actually interesting. Today, I picked up this book that I started reading, I think it was 3 years ago, because it was before I went to Oregon, before we moved for sure. It's a John Grisham book called The Broker. And it was a good book, and I had been reading, but then for some reason I put it down and never picked it back up. So today, like 3 years later, I pick it up, start paging through. It's like, I think this is about where I stopped. And
did you remember anything?
Yeah, I did. I remember sort of what was happening, and I'm almost finished.
Uh-huh.
So, anyway.
Yeah. Did you read a lot as a kid? Like, I think that's where my love of learning or love of reading started.
Yeah. Yeah, I did. I read The Boxcar Children, like we were talking about before, and let's see what else. That was the main one. Like, so what did you read as a kid?
The Little House on the Prairie series. I read those a lot.
How much of
the movies? I remember everything. Charlotte's Web, Girl Limberlost, several others that maybe aren't so well known, but
my mom just told me today that I have to read Girl of the Limberlost at some point in my life. She said I have to read it.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think you're right. Like, when you're young, I think if you pick up and start reading, it somehow just gets easy. Maybe it's easier for you than if you try to come to it later.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
But it's still important later, even if people didn't start when they were kids.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so. I mean, one thing I was thinking about today is, you know, if you like reading, maybe it's easier to read the Bible. You know, if you're familiar with already,
mm-hmm.
like sitting down, coming to a book, and reading.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah. Why is it important that we don't stop reading books?
Ooh, there are so many reasons.
Yeah.
Like, statistics show that people who read, they're smarter, I think.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
They have better vocabulary. That's one thing. It's supposed to increase make your memory better, supposedly. But I don't know. I think maybe the reason I like it so much and why I think it's important is because stories change us.
Mm.
And
mm-hmm.
like, I think a lot of my worldview was formed from books, especially as a kid. Like, I remember getting into a book and getting so frustrated at the characters that I had to actually forgive them too when the main character did. Seriously, it was intense. But like, forgiveness and courage and kindness, those are things that stories embody.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah, those are the kind of things that it's hard to teach people those things,
mm-hmm.
maybe, but like, you can learn them by watching other people like show you in a story.
Mm-hmm.
So when you read, what do you prefer? Do you prefer to read, you know, MacDonald, Chesterton, older or like new? I mean, not one or the other, but like, what have you been reading? What do you prefer?
I like a combination of both. I've read some McDonald this year. And then there are some newer authors too, or newer books that I've read, like the book Thief, All the Light We Cannot See. There's some.
Oh, yeah, I read that one.
Yeah.
That was a really good story, All the Light We Cannot See, yeah.
So I think I like a good mixture of both because I think it's important not to lose all the books that have already been written, the good stories that already exist. But
mm-hmm. So do you go back and do you reread things that you've already read?
Yeah, when I, like, if I don't have a hoard of new books, then I can do
yeah.
it. But I do. C.S. Lewis said that, like, a book isn't worth reading unless it's worth rereading.
Mm.
And that we should, like, after reading a new book, we should at least read one old book.
Yeah.
After every new one.
That's hard. I that's probably true. I don't think I do that very much at all, though. I'm trying to think back to the last book I reread.
I did that when I was a kid.
Did you?
I did. Like, I had books I read over and over and over again.
I know. My brother does this with Louis Lamar books. Or like he used to. Him and Deb, they just read them. They're like, yeah, I've already read it a couple times, but I think I'll just read them again. It's like, God, there are other authors out there, too. I don't know. I think for me, there's a part of it that, like, I love to read, but I also really like, I don't know, just the feeling of finishing a book.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes when books are boring, I'm just like, I'm not gonna stop because
mm-hmm.
I want to be able to like know that I finished it and I've read that, so I don't want to stop
too.
And I want to keep going so I can finish it. But at the same time, then I don't hardly want to reread because there's other things I could be doing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I think the books I would choose to reread are probably the ones that were, I don't know, I guess that stayed with me the most,
mm-hmm.
or some of the ones that I enjoyed the most. Like those are ones that I kind of look at. I'm like, oh, I really want to read that again because I remember what it did in me.
Yeah. So, do you have a book that stands as your favorite book you've ever read?
Oh, that's a hard question. This one is close to the top if it isn't.
Mm-hmm.
Till We Have Faces by C.S. Lewis.
Really?
Uh huh.
That was one that I started and I could not finish.
Really?
Sorry.
Oh, it's okay.
Yeah, it's abstract.
Uh huh.
Definitely, because it's about. What is it?
It's
about?
A myth.
It's
like, it's a myth retold.
Yeah.
After I read it, one of my first reactions, I was kind of like, okay, I don't think I really get the book.
Mm-hmm.
But I went online and looked at commentaries of the book, reviews of it,
mm-hmm.
and it was interesting. Like, there were some really enlightening things on there, that people who kind of explained what this meant, what was going on in the story.
Yeah.
And then it really kind
totally.
Of clicked in my head.
I think that's one thing that's really important. Like, sometimes, this just happened to me recently. I just finished a book called Lord of the Flies. Have you ever read that?
Yeah.
I would highly recommend it. It's really good. I finished it, and I was like, man, I think that was really important. But I don't know if I quite understand what it was about.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was, like, this post-book thing, a few pages at the end that some other guy had written. And I was like, wow, yes, that's what it meant.
There you go.
So I think that's one reason, too, that books are really important is because, like, sometimes you have to read the postscript to a book to understand what it meant, but then books in themselves are kind of, I think, that for our own lives. Like, sometimes I don't understand what's happening in my life,
mm-hmm.
but if I read about it in a book where it's happening mm-hmm. to someone else, you know, you just step back and it's a little bit easier to see.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah. So, books getting turned into movies.
Yeah.
Bullet point number two. How do you feel about that?
It depends on the book and the movie, honestly.
Yeah. You mentioned Lord of the Rings.
Yes.
I mean,
so
what could be better? That one worked out, right?
Or not.
Yeah,
I mean, it did in some ways. The book is so big and so detailed that the movie had to cut out a lot of it.
Yeah, there's just no way.
And so that was hard. Like, if you know the book and you like the book, and you are like, very loyal to it, then it's hard.
Well, books, right? I mean,
right.
We're talking like, three big books.
Three long, big
yeah.
books. So if you're a fan, and then you watch the movie, it can almost feel like a betrayal if
yeah.
some of those things are left out.
Sure.
But for what they did, I mean, it's a different method of storytelling, so you can include everything.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, I think it was very well done. And I think it kind of gave, I don't know, it kind of gave just a picture and a context to the characters. And
yeah, and why don't you just say a little bit about, we were just talking about this before we hit the record button, but about people who don't like to read being able to experience.
Yeah. One thing I think is cool about books being turned into movies is that, like, for people who don't enjoy reading, it still gives them a chance to know a story.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not everyone grew up learning to or loving to read. Not everyone has the time to read much. And so if it's turned into a movie, it's a lot easier to sit down for an hour and a half and get the overall idea and main point of the story.
Yeah. You, yeah, if you don't have time to read, anybody else?
Sorry.
That's you, your
that's
secretary.
That's the answering machine
that's
in the background.
Secretary.
Yeah. Just ignore it. It'll be fine.
So, along with that, one thing that I found I really like, and hardly anyone else I talk to likes to do this, but I think it's cool to watch the movie and then read the book, because my theory is that you can't be mad at the movie there. And I know some people really enjoy the part of reading a book where, like, you know, your imagination, you kind of conjure up
yeah.
what you think it's supposed to be looking like. But if you watch the movie first, then you have this context and you know what the characters already look like. And then there's so much more in the book that they go and do. So you're like, wow, this is even better than I thought. That the best example that I can think of is Sahara. Have you watched Sahara?
I haven't, no.
I thought it was great. Then my dad read the book and he was like, that's far out. There's no way that could happen. I thought it was a great movie and book. So tell me about two or one of your heroes.
Okay. First one that came to mind is Corrie ten Boom. She lived in Holland during World War II. She and her family hid Jews and kind of helped them escape, get out of the country and get to freedom. And then she and her family ended up going to concentration camp.
Even though they weren't Jews.
Even though they weren't Jews. And her father and sister died in the concentration camps.
Wow.
But her story in her book is just incredible. She was such a humble person. And she didn't strive for greatness, but God used her because she was faithful where she was.
Hmm.
She was there when he needed her. And
yeah,
it was just.
And what is her book that she wrote?
The Hiding Place.
Hiding Place?
Mm-hmm.
I'll have to read that.
Yeah,
and she wrote the book. It's not just her story. Right?
I think so.
Okay.
Yeah,
yeah.
I'm pretty sure she did.
That's really cool.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a great story. It's one of those stories that will stay with you for a while.
So, now the last part, the giveaways. This
Yay.
Is always the cool part. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to give away a book. And this is a book that you haven't read, right?
Right.
But it's a book that... It's kind of a common theme in my life. My mom brings books home from the thrift store, and it changed my life. This one's called All Over But the Shoutin' by Rick Bragg. And, man, I really love this book. I think for a lot of different reasons. But so it's a memoir. Like, it's his own story that he's writing. And Rick Bragg was a kid who grew up in the Deep South after slavery. But he definitely was out picking cotton as a kid and dirt poor. And... I think there's something about being a Southerner, like, you know, we're kind of proud of that.
Mm-hmm.
But when I read this book, it made me realize how much, like, I had no idea what that culture was
mm-hmm.
like, you know, 50 mm-hmm. years ago, what the Deep South was like. And even,
mm-hmm.
and I think even still is, in some ways, we just, you know, we're kind of isolated in our community sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, this is the story of how he went from being a dirt poor kid picking cotton to... He's now a professor at the University of Alabama, and he was a journalist for, I think, the New York Times.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That sounds really good.
It's a really cool book. And then the music we're going to give away today is one of my favorite albums. It's Anything Worth Saying by Aaron Shust. You said you've heard some of these songs?
I think I heard it years ago.
Yeah, I was talking yesterday, well, the last version of this podcast about how I'm not really big into worship music, but this is another album of worship music that it really blows me away. This album has got My Savior, My God, which is like one of the greatest worship
yeah.
songs. More Wonderful, Matchless, Change the Way. It's got a lot of great songs. So
didn't he grow up close to this area?
I don't know. Did he? It's published.
Maybe I'm thinking of Beatle Mormon. I don't remember.
I don't know. It's published out of Atlanta, Georgia, so it looks like maybe he did.
Oh.
Anyway, so whoever wins that, hope you like it. Trina, thanks for being here today.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks for the coffee.
You're welcome. I'm glad you liked it.
I have a French press, but I don't use it very much, so it's
maybe inspiring. You will then.
All right. See you guys.